in the world. But before we do that, or while we do that, the next person I'm trying to think about within the context of this conversation on identity, all the identifiers that can be used to describe our complex identities and how to do that when introducing someone. And so I asked him how he'd like to be introduced, and he said he'd like just to be introduced as a person. So I think that's appropriate. You can either use all the identifiers or you can just simplify it. So Hank Willis Thomas is going to come up and show us some of his work and talk about his work and help us move this theme along. So Hank.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Alexis and Holly, for helping me get here, because you were so diligent in all the ways of organizing. But I especially want to thank Hillary Pennington for providing the space, and Darren and his brilliance. And I want to thank you all because so many wonderful things have happened to me in spaces like this. I met Roberta Uno in a space like this, and I am so happy to be sharing this plane with you, P-L-A-I-N, plane with you, because I believe that we are kind of levitating on some level, or maybe on a level together, and hopefully continuing to go higher. And I want to say thank you. Oh, I want to take a picture. I forgot. Can everybody who has a smartphone take it out, who's on social media, and take a picture with me? Because there are all those people who are on, who are watching us at work or at home, and I want them to see what I see. And so I'm going to take a picture of you guys, and you guys can take a picture of me, and we can tweet it and hashtag Art of Change, just so that we have an acknowledgement of the various perspectives that are always happening at once, even though we may be on the same plane. Also, I like to start with the slide of all things being equal, because I always have to ask the question is, what is equality? And even when we get there, how long will it last? You know, what are the balancing things? But then I every time I talk, I want to acknowledge the people in the room. There are many who've kind of had major influence on me, especially and supported me, like Arnold Lehman, Jane Sachs, Rene de Guzman, Kara Mertis, and person I like to call Carrie Ma Weems. And I say that because my origin is, Carrie May has been a long part of my my story for a long time. And I'm going to actually start with another artist voice.
It seems to me that the artist struggle for his integrity must be considered as a metaphor for the struggle which is universal and daily of all human beings on the face of this terrifying globe to get to become human beings. What we might get at this evening if we are lucky, if the mic doesn't fail, my voice holds out, if you ask me questions, is what the importance of this effort is.
Now, when you were starting out as a writer, you were black, impoverished, homosexual. You must have said to yourself, gee, how disadvantaged can I get?
Well, no, I thought I hit the jackpot.
Oh, great.
It was so outrageous you could not go any further, you know. It had to be, so you had to find a way to use it.
James Baldwin, who are you?
First of all, I'm speaking as an American citizen. I'm speaking as also as a grandson of a slave.
My mother was born in Maryland, my father was born in New Orleans, I was born in New York.
Someone who represents a very complex country which insists on being simple-minded.
If I were originally from Dakar or from wherever I was in Africa, I couldn't find out where it was because my entry into America is a bill of sale. And that stops, you know, that stops you from going any further. At some point in our history, I became...
Nobody knows my name.
Baldwin's nigger.
James Baldwin, who are you?
Don't you care enough to find out?
There are days, one of them, when you wonder.
When it rains 5 days and the skies turn dark at night.
What your role is in this country and what your future is in it.
A boy last week,
he said, I got no country, I got no flag. He's only 16 years old. And I couldn't say you do.
We don't even have a country.
I know that.
Do we have a country?
You say you have this, your country, which is not your country. What flag on a black man's flag? You have no flag, brother.
Speaking now as though I were your educator, as though I were your teacher, I would beg you to ask me why, for example, your history books are the way they are.
When I was growing up, I was taught in American history books that Africa had no history, and neither did I. That I was a savage,
Gumba,
about whom the less said the better, who had been saved by Europe and brought to America. And of course, I believed it. I didn't have much choice. Those are the only books there were. I'm compelled to doubt my history, to examine it. I'm compelled to try to create it. I'm trying to excavate my history from all the rubble that has buried it for so many hundreds of years. And that means that I have to question everything.
That's just an excerpt from a piece called A Person is More Important Than Anything Else. It was commissioned by New York Live Arts, Bill T. Jones, and Lawrence Wechsler with support of the Ford Foundation. And I think about this notion of a person being more important than anything else because I have to remind myself about that, about myself every morning. And how do we come to value ourselves and value each other is a question I think about all the time. I think about the role of photography and the role of artists in it and the role of collaboration between artists like Roy de Carava and writers like Langston Hughes, who did this book, Sweet Flypaper of Life, which this girl saw at a library in Philadelphia when she was 12 years old. A little black girl from North Philadelphia saw this book and it forced her to ask some questions. How come she hadn't seen images of African Americans like those images? And where could she find more? And so about 10 years later, she actually wrote a research paper where she wanted to write a research paper about Black's contribution to photography from 1840 to 1940. And you can see she went into all these ways in which she couldn't find enough resources about African Americans in photography, so she wanted to do the research on her own. And when I met her, she was actually working on that work. That's my mom, in case you didn't get it. And just a few years later, she was able to publish her first book, which was Black Photographers 1840 to 1940. And it's important for us to really think about the value of that. 1840, the fact that African Americans were making photographs, taking pictures when photography was invented, rewrites our whole notion of the black experience. Because none of us in this room who are relatively educated could figure out physics, chemistry, enough to make a camera and make photographs in the way they did, especially with all the adversity they were facing. And the images they were creating were so much different than the images that mainstream society was creating. And I think that's what I learned in that book and then her next book, and 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 her next book. But that, all that to say that, and if you ask her, she's like, I'm just a little black girl from North Philadelphia. And that's the way she sees the world. And so it's not about having the money or having the power, it's about having the drive and the willingness to ask the questions and be vulnerable and find new things. And so coming from that experience, I realized I was always interested in questions, but also in frames. And in high school and in college, I'd take pictures with frames within frames because I was always interested in how there was as much information going on outside of the frame of the camera as there was what's inside of it. And how could I speak about that? And so that's my mom and I's first collaboration, or she's holding the frame. and this is another one called Sometimes I See Myself in You, because I really do see my work following it in her footsteps. No offense to my father, who may be watching on a live stream. Happy birthday, Aunt Yvonne. It's my aunt's birthday, and she always watches the live stream. But I really start to think about kind of how identity comes to be, and where notions of race fall into it, how they become shaped and how they change, and where images like this come from and images like this. But also, where do images like this come from, and how come most of us have not seen them? Anybody know who this person is? Nobody knows who this person is. This was the most famous African-American performer of his time, Burt Williams. And the reason that we don't recognize him is because this is how we knew him. And I was so fascinated when I realized the way that America celebrated him for performing blackness versus the way that he performed blackness offstage. And so we always have to think about when we see people getting paid, what are they getting paid to do and to what end? And it's not to besmirch him, who was also one of the very first benefactors of the Harlem Renaissance, among other things, but to really think about the stories behind the stories and how things that are the status quo at one time change. And there's these dramatic flips of the switches that we sometimes overlook, and they do rewrite our history, and our history is always being rewritten. And so I sometimes, as an artist, am looking for ways to look at things from the past and the present and think about how certain bodies from one time might have been treated in a different era. But I also think about our language of today, which is advertising. I think advertising is the most ubiquitous language in the world, and all of us speak it. We don't even have to actually know we're reading it to read it. And so I look at logos as hieroglyphs, and I think about how I could use the language of advertising to talk about things that advertising couldn't responsibly talk about. So I think about how black bodies were branded and traded on market then, and how we all live in an age of branded consciousness as we tweet and Facebook and Apple computer our lives to death, literally. And how so many people's notions of success is chained to success through sports and entertainment, how the society of the spectacle changes in certain ways, but also not so much, and how in even multi-billion dollar industries in the 21st century, you have the descendants of slaves working for free on the fields their ancestors used to till. And there's these ways, all of these things that happen that in my life, I also think about how commerce relates to them. This is a photograph from my cousin's murder. And I retooled it to use the language of the MasterCard Prices campaign to talk about how even in mourning, we're still being marketed to. And the complexities of my cousin's murder over a petty commodity, and the ways in which commodity played into the aftermath of that, but also how we are the descendants of commodities, and how the problems with race for me are that the craziest thing about blackness is that black people didn't create it, that Europeans with a commercial interest in dehumanizing us created black people. And so you take people from a huge continent with thousands of languages, thousands of worldviews, hundreds of millions of people, package them into ships and send them halfway across the world and tell them they're all the same. To me, that's absolute power. The fact that I even have to define myself as black when I'm clearly, nobody knows what color I am. Brown. Is that hard? Because we've been trained to not see this. And the problem is that you can be as light as some other people. Are you light? Are you black? Yes, you are. Thank you. Are you black? All right. And the fact that we define things in this binary when most people in the world are not black or white, they're Asian, who range in complexion from the darkest of us to the lightest of us, really speaks to the absurdity of these kind of racial categories and how they, I think, interest in where they start, but also where they end. People ask me where I come from, and I say, you know, Africa, America, because I live in this kind of hybrid space, like artist Sanford Biggers, who's in this work, who are constantly dealing with the fuzziness of kind of who we are and how when we change perspectives, it changes our vision of what's clear and what we know. And I'm constantly trying to remind myself and remind others that what you see on the surface is not me. And I think it was amazing that just a few years before I was born, it was necessary for people to stand collectively and affirm their humanity. And I thought I'd never see a day like that again, but we're living in it now. But I made a piece inspired by that, which I'm so happy is hanging just on the 10th floor. I wanted to think about a 21st century meditation on this I am a man statement, and I remixed it and to a series of texts, but I like to read the last line as a poem where it says, I'm the man, who's the man, you the man, what a man, I am man, I'm human, I'm many, I am I am, I am amen. Because I realized that rather than validating myself or others on anyone else's standard, that the greatest gift that I was ever given was my consciousness. And we recognize often how people, even the person who we believe in some ways is the smartest person on the planet, can barely speak. Thinking about Stephen Hawking. So how do, you know, what is our willingness to acknowledge that we always have something to offer, no matter what is taken away from us, is something that I'm constantly trying to remind myself and to remind others of. And thinking of I am somebody was a statement I learned from this guy. And he's often made fun of in different ways, but also I think the power of affirming that I am somebody is important. And the silliness of buttons, which we don't really wear in the same way, I think we lose what it meant for people to like put on something and be like, this is what I stand for. You don't even have to ask me because I'm wearing this to tell you this is what I care about. And I think about how when you call something art, you can take things that are kitsch and give and put them in a new lens and ask people to talk about them differently. And thinking about, again, the affirmation of I am and how this person says, I am the greatest. Who's the greatest? Ali. Again. Who's the greatest? Now, we've also watched him deteriorate into something else, but he's still the greatest. And to think about someone who was born in the segregated South, quote unquote poor, but I believe, you know, poor people are actually many of the wealthiest people in the world, because there's a quality of life that we have when we don't have, that we don't, awareness that is lost sometimes when we get too comfortable. But for him to say, I am the greatest, and then to force us through his sheer will to believe him at that time, speaks to the power of self-affirmation and also and the absurdity of being an artist, which I believe he was, is. And I think about how I could, so I made these pens that are larger than life that you contend with, and they have political statements, they're political buttons, and they ask us to really think about how movements get started and who carries them through. And think about people like Amelia Boynton, who 50 years ago, just a few months ago, was brutalized by the police just as part of the Selma March, trying to march so that we can do something that most Americans don't do even today, which is vote. But also to think about how other protesters, other people who are have been kind of dealt with, and how our society sees certain bodies in certain ways, no matter how big, small, or threatening they are. I'm constantly trying to find the images that we've kind of packed away and think about where we can show them again, how we can talk about them in a new way. So I find images like this from South Africa, where someone who was being ported off to somewhere that maybe never to be seen again, but wanted to leave a message with their comrades to the others, you know, Amandla, power to the people, that my struggle is our struggle. And even if I'm gone, it'll persist. So I'm making these sculptures that hopefully invite viewers to walk up to the work and try to meditate on the moments, like these people collectively burning their passbooks in apartheid South Africa, this gesture that could land you in jail for 5 years or more if you happen to be alive. And how what it means when we raise our voices, and also when we make art that can this is an image that I've always felt guilty to look at by Ernest Cole of miners being strip searched. I feel guilty because I'm always looking at their butts because I'm gawking when I look at this image. And so when I remade it as a sculpture, I wanted to like crop it like I think about with photographs. And so I cropped it and titled it Raise Up, not knowing that just 6 months later that this work would have a very different meaning. And I realized the power of shifting the lens and giving a new conversation to the ideas and the ideals that we're all reaching for, but also thinking about where the past meets the present, where this is a horrifying image. We watch these little hands on barbed wire in Auschwitz, and thinking about them bronzed in this way actually calls to mind the millions of other children that are living today with their hands on barbed wire, and how we somehow live in a removed state from that. And constantly trying to think about the now and the then, and how there is no single struggle. It's a collective struggle that will be now and it will be in 3013. Because the progress, the road to progress is always under construction. And thinking about the revolution not being televised, this was a moment when I was 13 where the revolution was televised and it had an indelible mark on me. And I wanted to crystallize that in a sculpture and think about how this image of quote unquote white hands becomes black hands, become universal hands and almost the hands of creation. And thinking about this idea of transcendence in public bodies through this image of the Harlem Globetrotters and the Statue of Liberty, which has now recently been acquired by the Brooklyn Museum. And thinking about lip sports as a metaphor for all the struggles that we kind of have individually and collectively. Although I think sometimes we put too much value on it, I think we also don't actually appreciate the ways in which it can be used to talk about different things. And talking about different things and asking new questions is central to my work that's also been supported by the foundation.
My question to the black man in America or anywhere else is, what is common to all of us that we can say makes us who we are?
This is a project called Question Bridge Black Males, and I messed my slides up. But this is a question that really kind of was fascinating. It says, what makes us what's common to all of us that makes us who we are? And so we did this project, Chris Johnson, Biate Ross Smith, and Kamal Sinclair, and I. We ran around the country. We asked that black men to ask questions, and we'd show those questions to other people. And the slide that's in the wrong place is this one, because this is me, this is us, this is Biate's work. But what he was dealing in this work called Our Kind of People was how in each of us, there's several of us. There's a rainbow of people within each of us, and we frequently always are kind of dumbed down to one person, and that can be detrimental to so many of us. And thinking about that, we showed that question to this young man, and he answered it this way.
Our commonality is in our history, but I think our beauty as black people is also in our diversity.
And I think the diversity is often overlooked. I think we have this myth that just because we look different, that we're diverse. But I also ask the question, I also think that just because we look similar doesn't mean that we're the same. And so Question Bridge Black Males was this journey which was first presented at the Brooklyn Museum and Oakland Museum. I got the Hank cheering squad here today with thanks to Kara Murtis, who was one of our first mentors. But we traveled the country and we asked black men to ask questions. And through asking black men to ask and answer each other's questions, we as black men and a multi-ethnic woman realized that there was no one way to be a black male. And so there's this absurdity we kind of wanted to show the container to break the container. Because if I am so many things, how can you try to make me one or the other? And we made a 5-channel video installation, brought it to Sundance and many other places. And I have to tell the Brooklyn Museum, they didn't give us enough seating apparently, because it had this amazing kind of response where over 60,000 people went to see it there. And we've traveled it to 30 other states, and over 500,000 people have seen this project in person. And interact in a number of ways. And just to give you an example of how a question can trigger a response, I'll show you this.
You know, I wonder, black man, are you really ready for freedom? And if not, what will it take for you to want and need this freedom?
So we showed this, we took this, this was a question from one of the security guards at the Birmingham Museum. And we took this to someone who was in San Francisco County Jail and showed it to him on a laptop, and this was his answer 3 seconds later.
Am I ready for freedom? And what would it take for me to want that freedom? First, I would have to stop and ask myself, that's a tough question. Because freedom to me is a mind state. You know, because you got some people that's not in jail, that's not free. You know, you got people that's in prison in dysfunctional relationships. You got people that's in prison with jobs. They work 9 to 5 that they don't like. Some people are in prison with alcohol and drug abuse. So I would have to, really ask myself, what's in prison in me? And what's been in prison in me is my self-esteem, my lack of self-esteem. My lack of self-esteem has led me to commit crime, to hurt people, to manipulate people, right? Because if I love myself, there's no way I could walk outside this room and punch somebody if I'm a sin within myself. So to be free to me would have to be, I would have to change, you know? So in order for me to grow, I'd have to change, because if change is necessary for growth, in order for me to grow, I would have to adapt the, I would have to adapt the mentality of something that's got to change in me. I would have to change my mind state. I'd have to change the way I talk. I would have to change the people I interact with. That would be free.
To me, that was just incredibly profound. To have someone who was in jail and show him a question and him to just spout that out, which was so much more eloquent and complicated than anything that I had to offer. That helped me to realize the context I find you in, the clothes I find you in, never define you. And if I'm robbing myself of an opportunity if I don't just do the simple act of asking a question. So we took that project and broadened it to interactive website, questionbridge.com, and a mobile app. And we're really hoping to take this platform, which is really an opportunity. So we have like 1,000 people on the website and over 1,000 question and answers. But really wanting people to, we want to take this platform and apply it to other things that aren't race, gender specific, because us as African-American men have a lot to learn from it, but actually the broader community has a lot to learn from it, because it's not really about black men. It's about people. What happens when people are put into groups, how they relate to the notion of the group itself, and how they find agency and freedom within that context. And I've constantly wanted to do things that Carlton, who's here, told me that it's Carlton, right? he said 2 years ago, he said, what I love about your work is that you're often trying to elevate and create a platform for other people to share their voices. And I realized that comes from my witnessing creative time first, shout out to Pastor Neck, on the internet, and seeing how artists were breaking the notion of space, but also having friends who worked for StoryCorps, shout out to David Isay over there, and realizing that there aren't enough places for people to use their voices. So my friends Ryan and I, Ryan Alexiev and Jim Ricks, collaborated on this piece called The Truth Booth with now probably about 6,000 other people, where you walk into speech bubble, there's a touch screen that says everyone has their version of the truth, what's yours? Speak for the next 2 minutes, starting with the truth is. And we started off in Ireland, and we had 600 people go inside the booth and share their truths. We traveled around Ireland, then a year later, Jim and Ryan took it to Afghanistan, which I thought was amazing. I was too chicken to go. And they got another few hundred of truth there, took it to Cleveland Art Museum, and we took it to Miami, to Art Basel Miami Beach, even took it to a presidential debate, made the cover of the Washington Post. And I want to share with you some of the truths.
The truth is not to be discovered, because it was there before we were born. It hid itself when we were born, and it only comes out again once we are dead. I'm nearly dead, so the truth will shortly emerge.
I believe that the truth is the struggle to find what it really is.
The truth is really small, it's very hard to see, but if you look really, really close, you will find the truth, and it's all around.
It is true that I've got a girlfriend that is named Rian, and it is true that my favorite animal is a dolphin, okay? And that's all I wanted to say.
The truth is, Molly, you're a bitch.
The truth is that I want to be an actor, a dancer, a singer, but I'm not sure how to get into the business. I've joined Trading Faces, and, well, I've joined the agency of Zaire, but I'm not sure if I'm going to get into the... Well, I am in the agency, but I'm not sure if I'm going to get anything out of it. And I just really want to be an actress especially, or maybe a beautician, or a singer maybe, or maybe a dancer, but I'm not sure how to get in. That's the truth. This was an Accident Keen production. I want to say hello to Melody, because she's my little doggy and all my other pets. And my parents. Peace out.
The truth, I believe, is little. Negro, big, think small, but believe big. Lego is in all our mouths. So the truth is very, very small. But think big. It's very cute. Thank you.
And that kid couldn't be more than 12 years old. And the fact that he said that the truth is for him is Legos, the truth is creativity. The truth is the opportunity to think of, take something and make something new out of it. And that just rocked my world. And when we went to Afghanistan,
حقیقت این است که من افتخار میکنم که یک افغانی هستم و ملیتم خیلی افتخار میکنم اما مشکل تنها مشکل و بزرگترین مشکل ما اینه که هیچ کس در افغانستان تنها افغانی بودن کافی نیست همه فکر اینن که مقام به دست بیارن صندلی به دست بیارن و پول ثروت جمع کنن کسی به فکر جوانان و آینده سازان این کشور نیست هیچ کس برای ما تلاشی نمیکنه کسی به فکر تحصیلات و یا به مقام های بالا رسیدن ما نیست کسی به فکر پیشرفت کشور نیست همه میخوان که ما همینطور عقب مونده بمونیم کسی نمیخواد که ما پیشرفت کنیم کسی به فکر ما نیست کسی برای ما تلاش نمیکنه کسی نمیخواد که ما در جهان مطرح بشیم فقط مشکل اونها اینه که مقام به دست بیارن چاکی به دست بیارن روی چاکی خود بشینن و تنها پول به دست بیارن نمیخوان که روی چاکی بشینن تا مشکلی حل کنن برای امنیت ما کسی فکر نمیکنه برای آینده بچه های این کشور کسی فکر نمی کنه کسی به فکر طفل های این کشور نیست هر سال طفل های زیادی می میرن بر اثر بیماری های زیاد بر اثر ناامنی اختطاف دزدی غارت ولی کسی نمی خواد برای این چیزها فکر کنه
حقیقت این است که ما از تحصیل خود فایده های بهتر دیده پس شما هم به تحصیلاتتان ادامه دهید
حقیقت خود در افغانستان می بخشین که هیچ نیست کلش چال است، نیرنگ است، فریب است و خود به قدرت رساندن است. دیگه کنم چیزی وجود نداره. ما در مدت 30 سال شد که پشت حقیقت نگردیم اما حقیقت پیدا کرده نتونستیم. که حقیقت در کجاست، واقعیت در کجاست اما ما موفق شده نتونستیم و ندیده تونستیم.
حقیقت این است. از به ظاهر آزاد بودن خسته ایم. حرف عمل می خواهیم.
To me that was just so powerful to see all the clips that came back. But to realize, especially to see the voice of the young women who are so often brutalized for trying to say a little thing but having the courage to come and put their faces and share their voices in the truth booth was fascinating. So it left me with this. And I guess we have time for a couple questions. And thinking about who we be, which I have a pleasure to be a part of Jeff's book. This is the piece that a piece that we made for the Oakland Museum that I'll play for like two questions or no questions. We don't have any questions. Thank you guys. Bye.
That was so great. Thank you so much. And we will have time for questions, but save them. So in the next panel, we will leave some time at the end for questions and for some ideas too from you. So the next panel is going to kind of take this question, this conversation around art, and move it into the space of social change. So we've got three panelists again who are working in that space and in the art space as well. You guys can come on up. And Laura Flanders, who is the moderator of this panel, who is the founder and the host of Grit TV, and she interviews people all the time, so she's going to do an amazing job here. And then we have Gail Christopher, Polly Carl, and Ijen Poo. Thank you, guys.
All right, no time for questions, but I do think we need just a little time for emotions. Yes. Anybody feeling a feeling out there? Yeah. Hank, really, thank you for your work. It was really moving, really beautiful. Alexis is totally right. I get to spend my time interviewing people. There isn't a better job in the world. I call it giving meaningful attention to the world's most important marginalized experts. And in that context, I've had the great pleasure and privilege of being able to speak with and listen to a lot of you in the room and some of our panelists as well. The thing about creativity is it at its best reflects that we live a kind of quantum existence where many things are going on at once. And I'm sure I'm not the only one today for whom many things have been going on at once. Not just today, but over the last few days. While we're physically here, how many of us feel that our hearts and our minds are elsewhere? And how many of us feel that our hearts and our minds are in Charleston, South Carolina? So I want to start by saying some names. These are the names of the people who were shot and killed in South Carolina, in Charleston this last week. Clementa Pinckney, Cynthia Hurd, Sharonda Coleman Singleton, Taiwanza Sanders, Ethel Lance, Susie Jackson, DePayne Middleton, Dr. Myra Thompson, Daniel Simmons Sr. And I'm saying the words because saying the words is so important. Saying the names is necessary. It's also insufficient to conjure up who those people and those lives were and remain in the hearts and minds of their communities. And I think that's a lot of what this panel and this day is kind of about, that saying our names is critically important, but it's not sufficient. And as Jeff pointed out, if it's commodified into surplus value, it's less than not sufficient. So I think in today's this part of this conversation, we're going to be talking a little bit about saying the names, why it matters, why it's insufficient, and what else need we do. So I have, as I said, the great pleasure of talking to a lot of people. I introduce a lot of people to each other. That's really the sum total of my job. And sometimes things resonate between people that you wouldn't expect. So one thing that two people that it couldn't be more different said that was almost identical recently was about how hard it is to be human. David Harvey, the strong Marxist economist, and Leah Piepsna Samarasinghe, the incredible disability justice activist and poet, both said in successive programs how hard it is to be fully human in an age where we are measured in terms of our profit and loss and usefulness. How hard it is to be human in a kind of hedge fund world. So that's where I'd like to start with our panelists, and maybe Ai-Jen, start with you. If we're here to talk somewhat about art and culture as enabling or creating space where we can be more fully human, how has it worked for you? Have you had an experience where art made you feel more expansive possibilities in your humanity? Humanness?
All the time. I was actually looking at the images from our last presenter and reminded of a set of images that a group of domestic workers took and are now on exhibit at the Museum of Modern Art, and it's called Shades of Us, and it's looking at the city of New York from the perspectives of domestic workers. And they took all kinds of photos of their neighborhoods, their families, the people that they work for, the playgrounds where they go to every day, but also of everyday things like getting on the subway and the tree branch that had fallen in front of their apartment building and the way the light hit the building across the street, and just being able to look at the world through their eyes and learning about Brooklyn anew, learning about family anew through their perspective, and realizing that the more eyes through which we can look at the world, the more beauty you actually can touch, and that something about what we do as social movements has to be about the democratization of the way that we can look at the world, touch the world, experience life and humanity, and a simple picture of a branch on the street is a reflection of the health and well-being of both our democracy and our humanity, and just gave me a lot of hope that when we can touch it in that way.
Gail, did you want to come in on this?
I will, and I'm going to ask you all to travel back with me in time to the 60s. And I was this little girl from Cleveland that was given a scholarship to go to Chautauqua, to the arts camp, before I did start out as an artist, believe it or not, many, many years ago. And so there I was for the first time in an integrated setting. And, you know, my roommate happened to be white. And so I was just adjusting to all this, but I was just myself, you know, and we became friends. So toward the end of the summer, and I also got a chance to perform on stage with Paul Robeson. So that tells you how far back, I know, really, like, life-changing. But I came home, and there was this ambulance in front of the house we lived in. And they were bringing my roommate out on a stretcher. And I said, well, what happened? What was wrong? And they said that she had attempted suicide. And she had left a note. And the note said, I do not want to go back to my home. My father, who is a police officer, has taught me to hate black people. And in this summer, I have learned that that is a lie. Mm. Now, that was an extremely humanizing experience for me on so many levels. I had a firsthand intimate exposure to the pain of racism and how it is transmitted and what it meant. It was also the first time that I had ever experienced any person having been taught to hate me because of my race. And so it really was, I think, singular in shaping my life's work in terms of figuring out why do we adhere to these absurd beliefs, and how can we overcome them?
Polly.
Yeah, gosh, I feel like there are so many experiences. I've had such a lucky career in the arts, but I go back to, I'm from Elkhart, Indiana, and I come from a family of very modest means in a very small town. And I was a curious kid, and my sort of saving institution, I always say, was the public library. And I can't tell you how many hours I spent there, how many books I checked out. And really, that was the start for me of understanding the necessity of spaces of public access, democratized spaces, for how I would imagine myself somewhere outside of Elkhart, Indiana, because there isn't much, there wasn't a lot of art, there wasn't theater, there wasn't much opportunity to engage worlds that were outside of my own, and so that space was the most formative. Much later on in my experience after many years of making theater, working in the theater, I had an opportunity to sit on a very early workshop of the musical Fun Home, which you probably all know about now because it won the Tony Award, but it was a very early time in the play, and sitting in a room in the public theater, and I realized that I'd had a whole career in the theater, and it's not my story by any means, really, except that it was the first time I'd ever seen anybody on the stage that even looked remotely like me. And I was like, wow, I've actually worked in this business this long. And it had never occurred, in a way, had never occurred to me. And I found myself in kind of just a puddle of tears, and I couldn't pull myself together. And I couldn't, and somehow my work that I'd been doing all this time was really, I just understood it for the first time. Like, I hadn't even demanded that of the business that I worked in a way. So that was another transformative moment.
One of the conversations that hasn't had a chance to really happen here yet, but it's been kind of percolating, is this question of identity. And you've each spoken to specificity and also kind of expansion. Gail, to you, do you think the categories of identity are more expansive today or more rigid?
Well, from my life experience, they're certainly more expansive today. And I like the term continuum and fluidity, as opposed to binary or tertiary in that sense. But recognizing that in many cases, people have the option of moving through various identity phases or periods or choices in many cases. in other cases, if that option is there, people are totally unaware of it, you know. I do think that there is an undergirding permission in our society. I call it, it's the DNA of America, that we were rooted in a belief in a hierarchy of human value. And that hierarchy descended, it's a belief from the 17th century that categorized the human family into groups based on geography and physical characteristics. And we built our society, we built our institutions around that fundamental mythology. And then we deny that we did it. You know, and so I think that that's, and once you had a fundamental mythology about human difference or permission to create an other, the people at the top of that hierarchy could opt to otherize anybody. And it happens, you know. So I think we have that core work to do, and we're a relatively young country. And I'm hoping that we will find the grit, we'll find the determination to do that work, to just take that myth, uproot it, and throw it out, and embrace our collective humanity. But we're not there yet.
This has been part of the work of Domestic Workers United, in the sense that you have a category, domestic workers, that was both invisible and not what was seen, if you know what I mean.
Right.
How have you navigated identity within your movement?
It's interesting. We're the workforce, we're the most visible, invisible workforce, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone sees domestic workers on the street every day, just right outside this office building, in our neighborhoods, know that their work is powering everything else, the work that makes all the work possible. And almost everybody has some direct experience with domestic work, whether someone in their family did it, or someone, or they were raised by a domestic worker, or there's just always a way that we touch this workforce. And yet the stories and the perspectives are so invisible in our society, and the work itself is so undervalued, and in fact, literally excluded from some of the most basic labor protections. And the fact that much of the workforce is undocumented, immigrant, disenfranchised from our existing political system in many, many ways, that we have actually grappled with this question of how we make social change, how we actually build the power to make the kind of change that can start to transform the conditions of life. And one of the things that we've happened upon is really understanding the power of story and narrative and cultural power, the power that comes from people's emotional direct experience with this workforce that is so widely held. And it's an experience that's about love. It's incredibly complex and unruly, but once you go to that place of story and allow for people's direct emotional experiences with that relationship to come forward, it can be so powerful when channeled. And I think we got a taste of that when the book The Help came out and the film came out and millions of people went to see it for lots of different reasons. But suddenly, you had a major Hollywood feature with two black domestic workers as protagonists in this film, and there was suddenly a little bit more space in the public imagination for the stories and experiences of domestic workers. And we realized how important it is to contend for the space in the public imagination for these stories and this human experience. And it is one of millions of experiences that are invisibilized in our economy today. And that's when we started to realize that part of the role of our movement is to figure out how we build narrative power, the power to tell the story of why things are in the world on our terms, and to connect with an emotional and personal experience that people are having across the spectrum of experiences and identities, because there is so much that is shared.
And you actually managed to do it without a white narrator. Little dig at the movie there.
Yeah. Well deserved.
I think just to unpack this for a second, if you haven't ever attended, I have, you know, a journalist, we get to go at all sorts of places. So I've sat in meetings at DWU and seen how the meetings happen. So when Aijin talks about story, this is not some concept dreamed up by the marketing division. This is practice. Can you just tell us what you actually mean? How do you hold a meeting?
Every meeting has an open mic where we basically go around in a story circle and people share a story about some experience they had at work. In our Caring Across Generations campaign, we actually start every meeting with sharing a story about someone who's cared for us and the value of that relationship in our lives. And it begins the conversation about social change from an entirely different place.
And this is even with laws pending and drama pending and budgets needing to be met. It's what happens.
Story. It coheres and it opens up a space.
Polly, to you. You've written about space and spaciousness in trans identity, among other things, many things you've written about. But you've also written about how the trans identity can leave you feeling kind of homeless. Alicia Garza, whom I had on the show recently, one of the co-founders of Black Lives Matter, talked about creating movements that were more like home for more people, that felt more like home for more people. So I'd love you to talk a little bit about identity, homelessness, home, and what you're learning about the role of art and culture in either celebrating homelessness or creating home.
I think that, you know, one of the things I've sort of written about a little bit is that homelessness is often a state of the artist, and so and in fact, you know, if you have a career in the arts, you rarely live at home. You have to be whatever city is presenting your work or showing your work, or and so there's a kind of transientness that comes with being in the creative life, and you know, for someone like myself who identifies as transgender, there's a homelessness that in my personal identity, so I could kind of relate to the arts and my personal identity as, you know, like I don't have a pronoun. Like, what do you do when you don't have pronouns? What do you do when you aren't at home in language or in space? And I think part of the movement building that we've been doing in the world of HowlRound and the world of Arts Emerson is really around how do people get to, how do we create spaces where people get to define themselves? And how do you create that as not as something that's programmatic or not as an initiative, but is actually holistic to everything you do? So I think about, and really we did a lot of studying about this before we dove into the world of HowlRound and where we're, what kind of, how could we create a space where anybody could receive an invitation to participate? And I think, you know, today's a great example. I mean, HowlRound TV is live streaming this and 200 people are watching who normally wouldn't get to participate in a conversation like this, and they're tweeting away out there. And so what happens in the space that we've built is it's a common space. And the idea of a commons is it's a place of shared resources. Well, guess what? There's tons of people out there that have resources to give to a common conversation, whether that's around the arts or, in our case, it tends to focus more around the arts and theater. And then there are resources that we have that we can share. And what happens when you get to nominate yourself to participate in a conversation, that you get to nominate yourself to tell the story? And what's happened by creating a framework where inclusivity is just there, it exists by the framework, it's no surprise, I guess, to me in some way that every kind of person showed up, and every kind of person has stepped into that frame of this common space that we created to tell their story. And in the span of, you know, 4.5 years of trying to just create a space, you know, in the last month alone, 56,000 people entered it. Like, you know, that's a sense of real need that artists have that need, and audiences have that need, and the stories are so multiple. And I think the big piece of learning about creating those spaces is that they're spaces of listening. I call it a curation of listening. Mm-hmm. Like, you actually have to get out of the way. You have to you know, quit thinking of yourself as the expert, and really listen to the stories that you didn't know, and they're kind of endless in a way.
But so, how do you get out of the way and quit thinking of yourself and presenting yourself as an expert and still get the grant? Gail, to you.
Will you answer that, Gail?
I mean,
that was interesting.
What do institutions do or not do to help this?
Well, we don't do enough. Let me just say that. But at the Kellogg Foundation, I have been privileged to be an architect of our approach to trying to achieve racial equity and racial healing in this country. And I want to really reemphasize and reiterate the power of story. And that's sort of the nexus, I believe, between movement building and art. The human brain is wired for story. 30% of our neurons in the brain are devoted to the visual cortex. And the power of story is that it creates images, images that trigger physiological and biological and biochemical responses, and they help to shape how we in fact respond to the world. So in our work, one of the things we knew early on was that we had to have what might be called, and this is an old term, but an inclusive approach to this racial equity work. And one of the lessons we learned about the power of story is when we bring people together who are so different from one another, but then we design and orchestrate a way for them to spend an entire day listening to one another. And usually the prompts for the listening have to do with their commitment to the work. You know, why do you do this work, et cetera. And it's amazing when you've heard 20 different stories in the course of a day that are a re-description, if you will, of a common dilemma, but through the eyes of other human beings, you are transformed in that moment. You suddenly realize how small you are, and yet how great you are, and how much capacity you do have to connect to another human being, and how the enemy isn't us, the enemy isn't them, the enemy is this absurd set of mythology and beliefs that we've created about one another and the systems that we've built. Now, in terms of what institutions can do, every institution has to be engaged, I believe, in that kind of work, the kind of work that creates a space for authentic relationships, relationships of genuine caring. Because if we're going to change laws permanently, if we're going to change structures, we have to be driven to do it by a higher sense of purpose to do it. And so I think that institutions have to do the work within, and philanthropy, which is the epitome of privilege. I mean, let's get real, people. You know, we have that 5% to give away, to trickle back down into the world as a result of the very systems that we're trying to change. And I mean, that's just honest, you know? And, but yet we have the privilege to do it. And we have to be diverse enough as a staff, as an organization, as boards, and we really have to be willing to make the creative investments. I'm so impressed with the domestic workers' work that you're doing, partially because it's an invisible phase of the African-American history experience. Very few people know that for a very long time, that was the only thing that a black woman could do. And the black man couldn't do anything. There were no jobs for him. But the only job for the woman was as a domestic, you know. And but this is not a phase of history that gets talked about, you know, that gets shared. And the laws were written so those workers didn't get Social Security. They didn't get health coverage. You know, they were left out of the bigger frame. Why? Because it was believed that they had no value. Mm-hmm. And yet lives were dependent upon them, you know. So we can do more. I think there is a movement within philanthropy to do more. And we can accelerate that movement intentionally. And now is a particular moment, I believe, in our society where there might be a critical mass of willingness to really do more.
The beyond the box, check the box question neatly sort of walked around, I think, there. Anybody else want to come in on this? Because that's part of what we have as a mission here is to talk about the challenges that are facing our movements, too. And one of the challenges, it seems to me, is always resources and competition with the very people we're trying to collaborate with.
I would add one thing to that. I think it's such a great, you know, I think you did it perfectly, Gail, but I would just add one thing, which is that there is this thing in the, when we think about these questions of funding and resources, and we think about the relationship between, you know, social justice and social change and art, And there's this spurious divide between equity and excellence, and I think we're still challenging that more, but I think we're still really stuck in it. That there's some work that's about social change, and there's some work that's about excellence and about you know, what makes good art. And I think, you know, the thing that got me really, I mean, the quest that I went on in my whole career has been a quest about who gets to determine what's beautiful. And where does to whose eye, and so I feel like that there's been a lot of conversation today about seeing, and I think we have to start to see what the bridge is between these conversations of equity and excellence, and I think as we think about resources, those things, they have to live together. They're not two different funding pools, for example. They're the beauty. And the beauty and equity we have to find a way that they go hand in hand. And so I think that's a challenge in the funding universe.
Do you want to talk a little more about how you're actually doing that, excellence and broadening access?
Well, I mean, I feel like in that curation of listening, there's beauty and excellence all around. And I think you know, one of the things that and it's not always my definition of what's beautiful, but it's because that's actually, we don't all share that, right? So part of the curation of listening for us, I mean, we at Arts Emerson, you know, we have 2,200 theater seats and a bunch of spaces, and what happens when, and we do this regularly now, but what happens when you turn over the curation of those spaces to people in your community, how does that change the conversation and what those spaces mean in the ecosystem of a city? I think for some people that sounds like really risky business. Well, what will happen? What if I'm not in control of it? What if I don't decide what the vision is? And of course, you know, the thing we've learned in the world of HowlRound, when we handed over the curation of HowlRound to the communities that use it, is that unbelievable things happen. I'm sure we could argue that some articles are better than others, and some live stream events are more lively than others. But part of the risk of it is letting those voices in, and seeing what we don't already know, or what we don't already think, or what we don't already deem as beautiful in our own minds.
Do you want to come in on this, Ai-Jen?
Well, just to build off of both of these points, I think that the fact that we're in a moment where there's more space in the philanthropic imagination for this work, I think, is a really important moment. And I think that the more that we can bring a both-and approach to how we think about this body of work, and understanding that we are still in a phase of a lot of experimentation about what works, but that it's both art as strategy and as solution. It's both resourcing artists and movements. It's both, right? It's a both and approach, and an approach that's about how do we test? And I really loved what Jeff said earlier today around how do you measure the opening of a heart, right? Just really continuing to ask ourselves, are we looking at impact and outcomes and from the place of what art actually teaches us about what matters. So not that we don't want impact, we want impact, but like, let's let art help us interrogate what that means.
I think that is a conundrum right now. It's a very, very, it's a constant tension. And this idea of modeling philanthropy after the corporate sector, you know, in terms of metrics for expectations, even being able to predict what you're going to accomplish through your grant making in terms of change, while we're in an era of change that is unprecedented in the sense that we are trying to uproot patterns and systems that have been in place for centuries since the beginning, and yet we're being held to a higher standard of metrics for immediate outcomes, there's a discontinuity there that is just beautiful. You know, very frustrating. And so I really appreciate the common sort of conversation. How do you measure changes of heart? But you can, mm-hmm. you know, you can measure it by behavior change, by expressions, by listening. And so part of our work is to create those new levels of measurement that are around the continuum of change, you know, not just, you know, are more kids reading by the third grade, or do we have fewer babies being born at low birth weight, but what are the indicators of changes in attitudes and behaviors and perceptions? What are the indicators that you are less biased today than you were yesterday? Mm-hmm. There is a science emerging there, and we can track it. We also need to be measuring what the broad media is doing in terms of shaping our consciousness as a nation. Violence is not beautiful, you know, and yet it is our dominant form of art, I believe, in our culture today. Violence is what we entertain ourselves with. Where is the beauty in that? You know? But this is, so we need to be talking about that and tracking it and talking about its impact if we're going to get to that place of humanity, which is what has been said so many times today.
I'm reminded of something Cornel West said recently on the show, where he said there's a difference between individualism and individuality. Like, he talks about smile, style, justice, fight. And that style piece that has helped African Americans specifically survive. And he also talks about what do you use your cultural idiosyncrasy, your cultural capital for. And he talked about the difference between the solo artist with the microphone uh-huh. and, you know, the whispers or you know, harmonic groups and what they elicit in terms of collective audience or what they recognize and encourage in terms of collectivity. So I'd love you to talk a little bit about art as, for a moment, as art as challenge. Because I think there's also some challenges here too. I was just in New Orleans, where artists have been part of gentrification, even as the recovery of New Orleans is being sold as a cultural capital. The indices show 52% of African American men in New Orleans are unemployed. And yet the recovery of the city is being celebrated. Somebody said to me, you can't have the art without the people. Aija, where are the challenges? Where are the rough edges between this world of art and the world of social change making as you do it?
Well, with caring across generations, one of the things that we realized is if we're actually going to achieve a society where we value caregiving work and caregiving relationships to the extent that we absolutely must, given our new reality and just the changing nature of the American family, that there are actually enormous cultural barriers in terms of our long-standing values and norms in this country that actually need to get unlocked. And the question of how we really have impact that's at scale and how we begin to chip away at and turn the tide on long-held, deeply held beliefs and norms in this country, I think is one that no one's really quite figured out. You can create disruptions yep. in a cultural narrative, but to really transform the long arc of how we value dignity and humanity across differences, I mean, I think it's a and so we've spent the last 3 years learning the institutions and the entertainment industry and the institutions that actually shape and define popular culture and understanding a power landscape that exists. I mean, we're organizers, so we think a lot about power and how you shift power and how you open up opportunities for poor people and low-income women and domestic workers to be protagonists in how we understand the future. And it is a hard road to sow. These institutions almost speak a different language. You know, when we first started going and meeting with people in Hollywood, I was like, I know you're speaking English, but I don't know what you're saying. You know? And so there's a translation that has to happen oftentimes between different types of artists and very powerful institutions with corporate interests. There are lots of different interests at play in terms of what's shaping our public imagination and a whole landscape that most movements don't really understand and know how to navigate. So it's taken us a long time to start to learn that. And it's absolutely essential to learn it if we want our story to really be powerful in society. And so there's a, I think, a big gap there that needs to get bridged and is starting to get bridged by some of the people in this room who I know are walking this journey with us as a movement. But I think it's something that we all need to start working more collaboratively around.
Mm-hmm. Polly, Gail, anybody, either one of you want to address this?
I'm thinking of a, I'm thinking of this question of challenge. I'm thinking of a quote from Maggie Nelson, an academic. She just wrote a book called The Argonauts, which is a great piece on identity, various kinds of identity. But in a section where she's talking specifically about trans identity, she says, you know, we're a culture, this is not the exact quote, but it's close, we're a culture that's obsessed with resolution. Mm. And sometimes we just have to accept that shit stays messy. Mm. And I think that for me, that's like my mantra, is shit stays messy. And that we have to be willing to live. I think the challenge is that we have to be willing to be uncomfortable, and that we have to be willing to live in that discomfort in this kind of challenging time as we're sorting out the relationship between art and identity. I find like that we want to we want everyone to feel comfortable or to feel, and we have lots of questions about what's a safe space, and I'm wondering about how we can sit in discomfort with each other and what that would look like, and how we could and not have to be driven to resolution or understand impact or but where we just allow that messiness, because I think we're in a really messy time, and there's some things that could be exciting about that messy time and some things that are really, really uncomfortable about it. I have to say, like, there was a moment in the whole Caitlyn Jenner experience where I just started freaking out. It was so messy, and I couldn't believe how messy it was, the way people were talking about it, and it felt very personally kind of threatening. And at some point, I just had to say, oh, I have to just stay in this messiness and discomfort. Like, I don't have to get to comfort about it. I have to figure out how to stay in how uncomfortable I feel. And so that's, I think, one of our real challenges in doing this, in doing this work.
Can art help us be comfortable with the messy?
It can. And, and I was going to say, art as challenge, you know, to look at that. I feel like art is changing, and art has changed. For, I'm speaking domestically here in terms of this country. And we're not benefiting from learning enough from the history of art and how art has been a force for change within our culture, within our society. And now that we have new mediums for communicating art to us, I mean, just art or culture or entertainment, we're sort of getting swept up in an energy now, and we're literally leaving our brains on the iPhones, you know? I mean, our eyes are so transfixed right now that we don't even know what impact that is having on us psychologically and biochemically and metabolically and just in terms of our behaviors. And so I feel like we owe ourselves the luxury of stepping away long enough to look at what's happening to us in our society and then embracing the opportunity and the challenge that all of this newness presents to use art, entertainment, culture, communication as a real force for positive change in terms of embracing our humanity. But I think this is and I applaud Hillary and the foundation for saying art is right at the nexus of what it is we have to do. Mm. And we need to really take that very seriously, rise to the challenge of making art a real point or resource for leverage for meaningful change, because it's happening anyway, you know, while we're sleeping, you know, so.
I'm tempted to turn to the question part of the conversation. Is that all right? All right, so if you have a question, raise your hand and we'll get the mic to you.
Or comment.
And in the meantime, I will reflect on how art keeps me in touch with life. I'm lucky enough to be many, many years partner with Elizabeth Streb, the wild action hero. And the guy who just wrote about it for The New Yorker asked me something about, you know, her relationship to my relationship to her work. And I said, you know what, in a pretty numbed out world. Yeah. Elizabeth's wild action, high impact work provides a brush with life. A brush with death too, obviously, but brush with life was what I was emphasizing to the journalist. All right, so has the microphone gotten to people by now? Oh, come on now. We're at that moment of what do we need to do? What do we need to do differently? It probably will catch you as you start speaking.
I guess I would like to push it even further. Instead of saying that things get messy, but I mean, I would offer that art is actually dangerous in the best possible way. And actually that's part of our job, is to make things dangerous so that we come up with new ways of thinking. So can you talk about your experiences with really pushing things to that place where it's dangerous, and you kind of had to come up with different ways of thinking about how to address it? I mean, I think part of why art is so dangerous is because it's not a simulation or a copying of experience. It's actually an authentic experience, and so that's also what's so dangerous about it.
I'll just share a story of a grantee that called us in the midst of the crisis in Ferguson. And there was this request for funding for what was being termed the people's art. You know, that there were all these television cameras in Ferguson, and, you know, nobody seemed to have any control over the images that were being, you know, projected. And so this particular grantee called us and said, we want to curate something that is the local people expressing themselves in terms of art. Now, we didn't know that CNN would pick it up and it would be all over the place, but it was right in the midst of everything in terms of the shooting and the killing and all of that. And so what it turned into was the hands up artwork that you all saw, the hands, and they blew them up, and they had them plastered over the stores that had been burned out, etc. And so, in a sense, for a major foundation that takes 6 months to do a grant, you know, to turn that around in a week and not know what the product would be was risky. I wouldn't go so far as dangerous, but it was risky for us as an institution, and it's one of the best grants we ever made. Mm-hmm. You know. Oh yeah, and we have to do more to fund creative artists. That when I walked in this morning and the word beautiful was in the air, I thought, wow, I'm on vacation. we're about social change. We're not talking about beauty, you know. And so, but I'm reminded that is the human soul needs that, and we have to bring that together more intentionally in our work.
I just would say that I think the work that HowlRound has done, I think, has been extremely, people have seen it as extremely dangerous in the, you know, how could, you know, there's a process to get to have a voice in our field. There's a ladder that you climb, there are doors you, you know, have to knock down. And for us to say, no, you know, actually anyone can come to the table, that, I think that's been a really hard thing for people to understand. I think people see it as really dangerous. Like, who's curating the conversation? I mean, I just saw a tweet 2 days ago. I wish HowlRound curated the conversation more. And I can say, we asked those questions for a long time. We talked about it. We're in dialogue in all those conversations. We're in editorial relationships, but just letting people have the microphone is extremely dangerous. And I think to turn over, sacred spaces in downtown Boston to communities, people talk about that work as dangerous. And I don't think of it that way. We've built the arts on the notion of exclusivity. If you think about the whole, that is why we exist. It's around patronage. It's around programs of subscription where you get better seats if you pay more, and if you donate more, you get more. And where do people go who demand exclusivity, which is what many of our patrons demand? And I think it's a real challenge to us to say, what if we were just today to agree in this room, we were going to get rid of all of our programs that were in our institutions that were about exclusivity. I mean, that would be, that's an incredibly, that would be an incredibly dangerous act. Who would be on our boards? Who would be giving us money? Who would be, so I think that's language that, that notion scares, I think it scares people.
From a political standpoint too, I think that way more, I mean, well, there's a lot invested in the boundaries around what's politically viable and possible. And artists are way less likely, and social movements connected to art are way less likely to be bound by those constraints. Mm-hmm. And I think that just a, you know, the first example that comes to my mind is the way that the LGBT movement and the artists who are connected to that movement transformed what was considered an impossibility into an inevitability, in terms of the freedom to love who you choose. That, I think, the power of story, power of storytelling, and artists played a huge role in that. I mean, I think Faviana's butterfly is dangerous, you know, because of the way that it challenges this notion that immigration is about you, or about those people over there. It's not about all of us. And that there's something in it that, you know, we can all identify with and see the beauty in. So, I mean, I think the, from the political standpoint, I could see for sure how people would say art is dangerous.
And
in the best of ways.
And just vocally taking on racism. I mean, just mm-hmm. taking it on. When the W.K. Kellogg Foundation said, the board said they were going to be the most effective anti-racist organization they could be in the middle of Michigan. Mm-hmm. You know, you have to understand the demographics of Michigan. And so that was a dangerous statement for that organization to make, and but they did it, and they stood behind it, and they put money behind it. And so that board of directors, you know, deserves a lot of credit for, and they did it because the founder said, do what you will with the money so long as it helps children. And we looked at the fact that most of the children in this country who are facing poverty, who are facing poor opportunity, are children of color. And so we couldn't fulfill his mission without, we believe, finally dealing with the elephant in the room, you know, which is this hierarchical belief system. I say that because people don't run out. You know, I usually say racism later, you know, after I say the belief in human hierarchy. But that, in retrospect, and that was 9 years ago, you know, that was a brave and courageous thing to do in the face of danger. And we've been able to do it without the risks that you saw, you know, in South Carolina. But we live with that. And we funded many, many grantees who are out there, like the Color of Change, you know, some of these artists who are making the bold statements, tackling the industry, you know, trying to get television shows off the air that shouldn't be on the air, that are perpetuating stereotypes. You know, there are many very courageous folks out there who are challenging the status quo, mm-hmm. and they're doing it because they cannot not do it. Mm-hmm. You know, they have to do it. So.
More questions? Oh, come on, people. Yeah.
So I was interested in, Polly, your comments about, you didn't use these words, I don't think, but in terms of the familiar culture wars dynamic between sort of quality and political art, right? Felt very familiar to me. And I just wanted to share, you know, when Creative Time organized the summit, which has become this very large international art and social justice conference, we did it because we didn't want to have that conversation anymore. It was towards no end anymore, right? So just not entertaining certain conversations and just making the assumption that artists who are working to social change are doing important and extraordinary art, I think really flipped the script in our field and for many people in very profound ways. So I just wanted to put that out there for those of you who are running institutions or have communities that are still entrenched in these kinds of conversations that get us nowhere, stop having them. Just take pride in the extraordinary work we're doing and move on. And nobody wants to look back. So I just wanted to share that.
No.
Oh my goodness, I have like 30 questions, which is why I'm, I don't know how to ask one. First, one thing I want to say is, could we be a little bit careful about the use of danger? Could we say risk?
I like that.
I think danger has a different meaning. And like Anne says, we reach a tipping point and we just say, I'm going to risk it because I'm stupid if I don't. So I think that's risk. My question that I can't really put exactly the order of words to is this. This idea of, first of all, may I applaud you for being able to respond like that and not knowing what was going to happen in Ferguson. Bless you forever. Please do it more, and please tell your friends. But one of the things that Jeff spoke about this morning, which you've raised again, this idea of how do you measure the opening of the heart, I wonder how we might start, or I'm wondering how I'm going to flip the script for myself around measurement of change. And there's a distinction between, I think, urgency and immediacy of change. And then I think that simultaneously in the ecology of our evolution or revolution, as Grace Boggs would say with the R in parentheses, there's an ecology of how we work. There's having to respond immediately and having to, I think, which is what art does, sow the ground for really long-term being uncomfortable, not being sure what we're doing, but knowing because we have instincts that something has to change and what does the change really look like. All this to say, this idea, and I raised it at the table with you, this idea of the risk that we might ask foundations to take, that we want to try this. This is what artists do all the time. We want to try this. We have no idea how the hell this is going to work out. The piece might really stink, but I'm going to do my very, very best to make it as rigorous and considered and inclusive and full of love and all those things as possible. And I wonder whether that process might be applied to thinking about the metrics in funding.
Thanks.
That it not, don't let me give you 2 years of metrics. Let me tell you in 20 years.
Thanks.
Well, that's a burgeoning movement in the field as well. I mean, we in our play space work, for instance, at the foundation, we say to communities, look, we're here for two generations at least. You know, we're here for 20 years or more, and we know this is going to take time, that it is a process. But I don't want us to sort of throw the baby out with the bathwater. I mean, we can measure different things. For instance, one of the things that we've been analyzing is the change in the social networks. I mean, part of, you know, the way we manifest our othering culture is that we live in our silos and we don't talk to each other who are different or perceived as different, you know. So we're able to actually track how that's shifting and how the communities have shifted who's in the room and who has relationships and how they're leveraging those relationships for meaningful change. And so, you know, I think what happens is the questions change. Mm. The questions change, and then the tools for tracking the change, they also shift. But to be, when some foundations will put out RFPs, and part of it is, a thousand flowers or a million flowers bloom, because they don't really know what's gonna happen. You know, they're just sort of saying, this is the problem, show us what you think might be solutions. And so that's another way to get to that question. But in
let's keep going, shall we?
But I just want to throw this to you. Sometimes
Melanie.
Metrics make a definition before we know what we're doing.
I agree.
And then
okay.
They make that definition.
Got it. I think I think this conversation could keep going, right? So we're going to have a break where that can keep going. But in the meantime, I want to lift some more voices, right? Here.
Yeah, hey, so I'm an executive director and I raise money, so I have to be an optimist by nature, but these conversations, I'm actually feeling my skepticism and pessimism emerge. I think I want to ask a question about fear, and I'm going to apologize in advance if I'm not able to articulate it the way I wish, but Jen, I really appreciate it. I wrote down, you said a lot of interests at play shaping our public imagination, and I really appreciate that. I wonder why, and maybe I'm misreading the world wrong, but it seems that fear, it's much easier to imagine the negative. Mm. Like, it's really easy to generate people's fear. So it's easy to get people in Texas to be afraid that Obama's about to take over Texas. Mm-hmm. Or it seems as though the fearmongers on the right mm-hmm. are really able to galvanize the public imagination to imagine the worst, mm-hmm. the worst possible outcome. Mm-hmm. While those of us maybe on the left more or wherever, it seems as though individuals might be able to imagine a better world for them. Mm-hmm. But it's maybe a little bit harder to imagine what a collective better world might mm-hmm. look like. Good. And I wonder why that is. And I wonder why it could be the drudgery that we all live in, and we just sort of resign to the systemic forces that we live in. But I wonder about that, and particularly in issues like labor movements and things like that, where there are opportunities where groups of individuals do engage and emerge for a collective battle to something better. But that doesn't necessarily always translate out to the larger public imagination mm-hmm. writ large. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Absolutely. Ijen?
I would say that I don't think we've really contended for the public imagination, really. Mm-hmm. I would say that we issue reports and analysis and charts and graphs, and sometimes we do good, support good journalism, but that in contending for the emotional life of people, speaking to that dimension of heart that is incredibly unruly and has a lot of fear inside of it, along with lots of other things, love, connection, redemption, all of those emotions, that social movements haven't had the tools, capacity, practice, we just haven't built that muscle to contend in that space of emotion. And so we've seeded all that ground, and it then is about fear. And so I would say that that is a huge role that activists and social movements need to really think about, is how do we really contend? It's about strategy, it's about plans, it's actually like, we got to get in there, and it's incredibly unruly and unpredictable and uncomfortable as a space. But as long as we stay in the realm of the rational, there will always be this whole other dimension of reality that is.
Can we bring in Apple Shop into this conversation? Because talk about up against narratives of fear. In the middle of Eastern Kentucky, narratives of fear abound, and you have a creative space that's making not just a cultural difference, but a political difference. What can we learn from you?
I'm Dudley Cock from Apple Shop down in the Eastern Kentucky in the coal fields. So a little bit of history. For about 125 years, Apple Shop's been a mineral colony. The economy has been controlled by outside interests. John Prine put it most succinctly, Mr. Peabody's coal train done hauled it away. And so you've had this sort of colony mentality, and yet now coal is going away. Mm-hmm. King Coal came 125 years ago, and King Coal has departed. Mm-hmm. And so a huge division set in to the region. You became either for coal or against coal. Now the paradox is coal is gone. So how much can you be for the departed? Well, it turns out a lot. And it's a real tension. And Apple Shop's in the 5th Congressional District, which is the poorest congressional district and the sickest congressional district in the United States. But unfortunately, rural America has disappeared from not only the foundation landscape, but from the public landscape. Mm-hmm. It has the poorest people, the sickest people. They die disproportionately, are wounded, suffer from traumatic stress syndrome, et cetera, et cetera. And then you have this overlay of what they're developing in rural America is for-profit prisons. And that means people from poor inner city communities mm-hmm. are being shipped, you know, hours and sometimes days away to be housed in rural America, already invisible. Mm-hmm. So you got a double invisibility, mm-hmm. and you also have an overlay of the old plantation system.
Absolutely.
Of poor white people guarding poor black people. So it's a very sort of complex thing, and that just needs more attention and more thought and more visibility. I really appreciate this theme of this panel around what's invisible and what's visible. Mm-hmm. I think that's a terrific theme. And then this idea of the democratization of beauty, what would that mean? So I just thank you. I don't really have a question, but thanks for the prompt.
Yeah. I'd love to get closing thoughts from our panelists if there aren't more questions, and maybe to prod some closing thoughts. I ran across what John F. Kennedy had to say in Amherst in 1963 at the opening of the Robert Frost Library. And he said, in America, our heroes, I think a lot about our heroes and what are the hero stories that we tell ourselves, and what if we told cooperative stories as opposed to hero stories. That's a lot about what we think about at Grit TV. But he said, in America, our heroes have customarily run to men of large accomplishments. But today, this college, speaking of Amherst and country, honors a man whose contribution was not to our size, but to our spirit, not to our political beliefs, but to our insight, not to our self-esteem, but to our self-comprehension. And then continuing, bless you. Continuing about Robert Frost, he says, it's hardly an accident that Frost coupled poetry and power, for he saw poetry as the means of saving power from itself. When power leads men towards arrogance, poetry reminds him of his limitations. When power narrows the areas of man's concern, poetry reminds him of the richness and diversity of his existence. When power corrupts, poetry cleanses, for art establishes the basic human truth which must serve as the touchstone of our judgment. The artist, however faithful to his personal vision of reality, becomes the last champion of the individual mind and sensibility against an intrusive society and an officious state. Mm. He has a lover's quarrel with the world.
Mm. Beautiful.
Can that lover's quarrel help us make a new world? I guess is the answer. She ad-libs. Any thoughts?
I don't want to. Well, I am reminded that it always has. In my life experience, you know, whether it was Hank Langston Hughes or Gwendolyn Brooks or Toni Morrison or, and the, it goes Isabel Wilkerson of late, mm-hmm. To find the stories of so many episodes of our nation's history that have become invisible, to find those stories and put in the heart and the soul and the energy to tell them, to share them in ways that just pull you in and hold you, you know, until they're finished with you and then they let you go, you know. I mean, the power of poetry and literature and movies, the power of art, the power of the visual, the photographic, to remind us of our humanity has always been a major component of change in our society. And we should be reminded of that over and over again. I think, and again, I applaud you, Hillary, and the foundation, because I don't know of any other foundation that is reminding us of that in this explicit way. You know, we're all trying to bring about change, but I think we've kind of diminished the power of art as a part of that change. So I'm really humbled that you invited me to be on this panel. And I think that, yes, we can have that lover's quarrel, because in the end, this work is about love. And if I can tell just one personal story, I will. You know, I think all of our work usually is an outgrowth of our life's experience in some way. And I was challenged to be born with a disability and had 25 at least. I stopped counting, I think, after 25 surgeries to correct that. And it happened to be that I was one of many a million or more who was born with glaucoma. And so I had lots of surgeries on my eyes. And finally, when I was, I think I was in my 20s, I'd had, and for me, they were surgery episodes because they'd go in and they'd operate, and then a week later, they'd say, it didn't work, let's do it again, right? So over and over and over again. So finally, this one surgery had happened, and they were saying, you know, it didn't work, we need to do it like a third or fourth time, you know? And at that point, the pain was unbearable, and I didn't know what to do. And for the first time in my life, I cried out. And I do believe some of this work is spiritual in nature. I cried out and I asked God to help me because I just, there was nothing else that could be done. And in that moment, I was gifted, whether it was my ancestors or my angels or what, but I was gifted with this impression. And these were the words, and I'll never forget them. The words were simply, love your eyes as they are loved. And it was the first time in my life I ever went to the mirror and looked at myself with love. And that became my guiding principle for life. I mean, ultimately, this racial hierarchy that we've created, this ability to other the perceived person, is institutionalized lovelessness. And our work, the work of the artist, is to bring love back into the center of who we are in whatever mediums or forms we are allowed to do that or we choose to do that. And so my answer to the question is yes.
Polly?
Well, I feel like we ended on that note. No, exactly. It's so beautiful. I mean, I don't have a lot to add to that, but to just say, I think, you know, the one thing I think a lot about is that we do sometimes want in this business to make it singular, about singular artists doing work, about you know, finding those singular heroic voices. And I think this work is really going to take collective action on all of our parts. And I think there's going to be, and I think we're going to have to think about that. I think we have to think about that at every level. Like, what does leadership look like? How does leadership look collective? How does the work we do? How do institutions and artists and communities come together? And so I feel like there's a you know, we're overcoming a kind of American narrative about individualism addressing this. And when you look at the, I don't know, when you just feel the weight of what's happening in the world, you know it's going to take all of us together, and we're going to have to figure out how to recognize each other in that and be together in it. And yeah, I don't, yeah.
All right, Jen?
Just to build off of that, artists and movements need each other, I believe. And it's that collaboration, that partnership, that strategic partnership that I think will ultimately unlock a different story about the future of this country.
Thank you, all three.
Wow. I don't know how you measure a heart being opened, but